Welcome to the UGC lecture series. In a series of 2 or 3 lectures after this, we are going to talk about an important concept of relational databases, which is ER modeling. Okay. So, let us look at ER modeling is nothing but entity relationship modeling. So, let us look at the objectives of this lecture, the first lecture on this part 1. We are going to understand what is meant by ER modeling, and we are going to talk about what is entity, what are entities, what are attributes, and we are going to understand the basics of relationship. Okay. So, now design is a process. It consists of analysis requirements from the user's viewpoint and conceptual modeling and then logical design. So, we are now looking at this part of it, which is the conceptual modeling, which is called as can be done using what is called as entity relationship diagram. So, and the logical design part also we are going to look at, which is transforming an ER diagram into tables and keys. So, let us look at the ER development process. In the first step, we have to identify the entities and determine the attributes for each entity, select the primary key for each, establish the relationship between the entities, and then draw the entity model, and then you test the relationships and keys. So, before we do anything, we have to, the first step in the design process is to identify the universe of discourse, which is called as UOD. It is when we are designing a diagram, we do not or a relational database. Basically, we are doing this ER modeling for designing a database, and the database cannot talk about everything on earth. So, what is it that you are going to talk of? What is your universe of discourse? That has to be designed. So, the database to be built will not model everything in the world, but rather some mini world or a small world, which we call as the universe of discourse. So, let us now, a relation entity relationship model consists of the following components: entities, relationships, and basically entities and relationship. And now, entities, we can talk about entities, entity sets and entity types. We will differentiate between these three. We will talk about attributes, keys and value sets. Then we will talk about relationships, types and sets, what is the degree, roles and recursive relationship, relationship constraints and attributes of relationship types. Some of this we will be taking up only in the next lecture. So, first let us take the first component, which is entities. So, an entity, what is an entity? An entity is a real world object distinguishable from other objects. Example, a student is an entity, a car is an entity, a job is an entity, a subject is an entity, a building is an entity. You should note that I have taken some which are physical objects like star, a student, car, building, and job and subject are abstract concepts. Both are called as entities. They have to be distinguishable, that is all. Now, an entity is described using a set of attributes. So, if you want to describe student, you should have a set of attributes associated with it, car and so on. And the same entity may have, it is not that all the entities will have equal prominence in all universe of discourse, it depends on the universe of discourse. So, it may have different prominence. In a company database, for example, the employee's car is of less importance. So, the entity car is of less importance. In the Department of Transportation Registration Database, cars may be the most important concept. So, we do not know when an entity, which entity has importance in which universe of discourse. In both cases, cars will be represented as entities, but they will have different levels of detail. Now, the notation, so we are going to draw diagrams, so you have to have notations. So, a rectangular box is how you represent a entity. So, this is a department entity, this is an employed entity, this is a project entity, this is a supply entity. So, what should an entity be? It should be an object that will have many instances in the database. If you have only one instance or one tuple, you do not talk about that as an entity, and it will consist of multiple attributes, and it must be about an object that we are trying to model, not something else, and it must have an identifier. You must be able to identify that this is a particular entity. And what it should not be, you should not have as entity the user of a database or the output of a database. That is not what is entity is. Entity is what the database is going to talk about, not the user, not the output. For example, this is an inappropriate entities. This is actually the system user. The treasurer manages the account. So, this should not form an entity. Similarly, The expense report summarizes, this is a system output, this should not form part of the entity. So, for this actual this particular UOD or universe of discourse, account is charged expense. This is the only part of the entity that is valid. So, this is the appropriate entity. So, you must be careful not to model user or outputs. Now, the entity type is a set of entity instances sharing the same common properties, attributes. So, what is an entity type? It is a set of entity instances or tuples as we have been calling it, sharing the same common properties, attributes. For example, a student entity can have ID, name, address and hobbies as its attributes. So, this is the type. Okay. I can have another student entity in another relation having student ID, course, classes, subjects taken or something like that. So, it is possible, but so the attribute along with the entity name will identify the particular entity type. So, it is characterized, normally entity type will have a name, so it will be employee, will have a description, instances belonging to the entity type E, will have an identifier which will uniquely determine every instance. For example, in this particular case, the ID is the unique. Unique attribute, okay, and a domain, the possible values that the attribute can have. For example, in this particular case, ID can have numbers, name can have some string of some particular, address can have some value and so on. So, that is all that not value, those are the type, those are the range of values it can get. So, that is called the domain. So, basically an entity type is characterized by a name like student, description, identifier and domain. And you have so the entity type name along with attributes and the key is called as an entity schema. So, the notation is like this, define sets of attributes that have the same attributes, entities having the same attributes. Each entity type is described by its name and attributes. Entity type describes the schema or intention of the set of entities. It does not have actual values, it just says these are the possible, this is the schema. Okay. So, collection of all, we have discussed the schema instance before also when we are talking about relational model. So, collection of all entities of a particular entity type at a given point of time is called the entity set. Now, remember the entity and the entity type should not vary over time, but the number of tuples in that particular entity is called the entity set, and that changes with time. So, you can insert tuples, you can delete tuples, and this is called the extension of the entity type. Entity type and entity set are customarily referred to by the same name. So, entity sets are collection of similar entities, all employees, all entities in entity set have the same set of attributes. So, each entity set has a key, has a domain, and you can map an entity set to a relation easily, which we will be seeing later. Okay. So, for example, this is a typical entity set, this is the SSN, this is the name and this is the salary. And these two together form the entity set. This employees SSN name SAL is the entity type, just employees is the entity. So, an entity instance example here is a real world thing. So, this Kim with this is a instance. So, that is about entity. So, we have seen about entity, entity type and entity set instances. Now, let us go to attributes. We said that entity should have attributes. So, any property of an owner entity, attribute type is a set of attribute instances expressing the same property of an entity type. For example, gender, you can have male, female, and an attribute instance is a particular property of an individual entity instance. For example, in this here, SAL is an attribute and 23,000 and 45,000 are the attribute instance. Next, you have an attribute. It need not be only one attribute or a joint set of attributes which uniquely identify the entity instances of an entity is called as an identifier. It should be unique and known, it must not be null, it should be short preferably, we are talking about this identifier or the key, it should be stable, it should not keep on changing. For example, I am talking about employee, his ID number cannot keep changing, I mean normally does not change, so you put ID as a key. If you say for example, his address and he is a person who keeps changing houses often, then address is not a good identifier and it should be unique also. So, there may be 5 people living in the same house having the same address. So, uniqueness property is also is the most important property and so on. So, what will you choose as the identifier of the entity type employee? Employee ID, SSN number, employee name, phone. Employee ID, in fact, in many cases in databases, you introduce a new attribute with an ID, an unique ID, so that you can have a key. So, for example, books, ISBN, title, price, this can be the primary key. So, properties, this is a representation. So, this is, remember, the entity representation. These are kind, this entity will have these in an oval shape. These are the attributes. So, the and the identifier or the key is represented with the underline. So, this tells me that this is the key. So, graphical representation in ER model, name, address, SSN, will come what this means later. So, this is the identifier. So, now when you talk about attributes, there are different perspectives of how an attribute will look like. So, you have key attributes, you have value sets of attributes, you have null valued attributes, and you have composite versus simple, single valued versus multiple, derived versus stored. So, let us look at all these in detail. So, let us look at key attributes first. Key attribute or uniqueness constraints are applied to entity types. Key attributes are distinct for each individual entity in the entity set. So, for example, suppose I have 1000 tuples corresponding to student, then there should be one attribute whose value is unique for each and every of these 1000, 10,000, 20,000, whatever those tuples may be. How many ever tuples you have in that entity, each and every tuple should have a unique value for this particular key attribute. Key attribute usually has a as its name underlined, must hold for every possible extension. So, how many ever you add tuples, this should remain valid. And you can have also multiple keys, that is two or more attributes can be formed. So, that is about key attributes. Now, let us talk about value sets. Value sets specify the set of values that may be assigned to a particular attribute of an entity. For example, I can say if the attribute talks about colors of a car, then one particular company may bring out only say 5 colors of that particular car, then that 5 colors, those set of colors is called as value sets. For example, employee age I am specifying should be integers between 21 and 65. Vehicle registration number should be string of 3 alphabets followed by 3 integers. Okay. And actually they map to the domains. When we talk in relation model, we have spoken about domains, actually it maps to domains. And value sets are not displayed on the ER diagram. There is no question of saying that it is an integer or whatever on the as far as the ER diagram is concerned. Now, let us talk a little bit about null valued attributes. A particular entity may not have an applicable value for an attribute. For example, this tertiary degree is an attribute for a student, not applicable for a person with no university education. If that is true, then there would not be any value. So, you will put a value null. So, home phone, even if it exists, you do not know the number, then you put a null value. Height, you do not know the height at the present time. So, these are some attributes which get null values. So, there are 3 types of null values: not applicable, unknown and missing. So, what is the meaning of this? Not applicable means it cannot have a value. Unknown, I know there is a value, but I do not know the value. Missing, I know there is a value, it is not found. So, these are null valued attributes. So, there are other type of attributes which we have already spoken about, that is, we have composite and simple attributes, we have multi valued attributes which we will be talking about here. So, let us look at composite versus simple attributes. What is a composite attribute? Can be divided into smaller parts which represent simple meaning attributes with independent meaning. So, aircraft type is a simple attribute. Aircraft location, which is comprised of latitude, longitude and altitude, these 3 together form aircraft location, and this is called as a composite attribute. So, composite attributes can be divided into smaller parts. So, we have seen this already, and this is the notation for this composite. So, an attribute with all its composite. Now, we are talking about single and multi-valued attributes. You must understand the difference here. Simple attributes can be either single valued or multi-valued. For example, a gender attribute can have only one value at a time for one tuple. Multi-valued attribute, suppose I have an attribute called degree, then I can have 2 values for it, MSc, MTech, for the same attribute. An attribute in the relation model must be always single-valued. That is one of the conditions we spoke about in the If it is multivalued, it is given as like this, but in relational model we keep the restriction, not in ER model, but in relational model we have the restriction that a single valued only is allowed, it has to be atomic, you cannot have more than one value, that is what we say. Next we have something called and of course I think we have already looked at how this multivalued can be converted into single valued function, that is also possible, but this is just in ER model you can have multivalued to understand the problem. Now derived versus stored attributes, this is another type of attribute description. Some attribute values can be derived from related attribute values. For example, I have birthdays and I have monthly salary. So from this birthday I can derive the value age, and from the monthly salary I can derive the yearly salary. So these two are derived attributes. The value is not given directly, only I can derive it from the values, known values. Okay. So some attribute values can be derived. So for example, it need not be derived from one. Here I have item with quantity and price is related to order, we will come to this later, is related to order, but orders total value is actually the sum of quality into price of all the items, quantity into price. So this total value is a derived attribute. Why we are telling this is here this attribute's value is derived from another attribute. This attribute which belongs to one entity is derived from the attribute values of another entity to which this entity is connected. So that is this example tells you. Just to conclude, parenthesis for composite attributes, brackets for multivalued. Assume a person can have more than one residence and each residence can have multiple telephones. So this is another notation, address phone, phone area code. So address, street number, number, street. So this is an example of how composite values and multivalued are specified. Now an attribute A is defined as a function like this, where E is the entity type, V is the value set, P of V is the power set, set of all subsets of V. Suppose I have 5 attributes, it is a power set of those 5 attributes, and value of attribute A for entity E is A of E. So for example, age is 35 for this particular attribute, the value of this particular attribute is 35 for this particular tuple, where E is an entity of type E. Now A is a simple attribute where A of E is a singleton, that is it can have only one value. Okay. So if I say degree and you have two or three, then it is no more an atomic value. A set with multiple elements for multivalued. So if you have multivalued attributes, you have to split it up, and an empty set for null valued attributes. So A is a composite attribute when the value set is the Cartesian products of all the component attributes. Okay. So now in relational model, entity type corresponds to a relation or table, which has been calling it. Relations attributes are nothing but the attributes that you have in the table, or the columns that you have in the table are nothing but the entity types attributes. The problem is entity type can have set valued attributes or multi valued attributes. So solution is you will use several rows to represent a single entity. For example, suppose I have this and I have this, that is this is a tuple. The problems with the solution is redundancy. So now suppose I have some ID number, name, address and collection, and in collection I have multivalued attributes, stamps and coins, then I can split it up into two tuples with these values, but there is lot of redundancy, all these three attributes are redundant, and key of the entity type is not the key of the relationship. So this is a problem, relation. Okay. So resulting relation must be further transformed. So that is what we are going to talk, we will see later when we are doing the transformation. Now let us talk about another topic, which is basically called as strong and weak entities. Okay, this is a slightly different topic of, it is more to do with understanding what the application is. So when you talk about an application, you can have dependent and independent entities. For example, entities B's existence is dependent on entity A. Some instance of A must exist before B can exist, this is the meaning of dependence. And if A ceases to exist, B also ceases to exist, that is also the meaning. So, an independent entity is not existence dependent on another entity, while dependent is. So this independent entity is called the strong entity, and the entity which depends on the independent entity is called as weak entity. So, the diagramming convention for this is, we will see. Typically, the identifier of a weak entity is a composite identifier which includes the identifier of the entity which the weak entity is dependent upon. So, when you talk about an identifier of weak entity, it will take the identifier of this entity itself and also its strong entity on which it depends. So, now example, this is an entity offering, and this offering depends on the course. Similarly, the task depends on the project. So, these are so here. These two are weak entities, these two are strong entities. Now, weak entities are represented, remember entity was represented by a rectangle, weak entities are represented by two rectangles like this, and a weak entity can be identified uniquely only by considering the primary key of the owner entity or the one in on which it depends or the strong entity on which it depends. So, owner and a weak entity must participate into 1 to n relationship type. We will come a little more in detail about this Cartesian later. And weak entity must have total participation in the identifying relationship, that means it should have an existence dependency. Okay. Now, again I will just repeat this. So, I have a strong entity and a weak entity. I am calling it like this because I am assuming that the weak entity is dependent upon the or depends on the strong entity. So, I will just call it a strong and weak. So, our owner here is called it as owner. Owner and weak entity or strong and weak entity which are connected to each other should have a 1:n relationship, that is for one value of strong you can have any number of weak, and weak entity must be have total participation, all the tuples of the weak entity, please note entity is a relation, all the tuples of the weak entity should also be there in the other one. Okay. Now, weak entities normally have a partial key, which is a set of attributes that uniquely identify weak entities related to the same owner entity. So, not every existence dependency results in a, not every type of dependency results in a weak entity, it depends on other semantics of the application and so on. Now, we have a term called a discriminator. Now, what is a discriminator? A discriminator of a weak entity set is a set of attributes that allow the distinction to be made. For example, the discriminator of a weak entity set payment is the attribute payment number, since for each loan a payment number uniquely identifies one single payment for that loan. So, I have a loan and the payment depends on the loan. So, the loan is the strong entity, payment is the weak entity, but in this weak entity I am going to have an attribute called payment number. And this payment number uniquely identifies each and every tuple in the payment relation, and it also uniquely determines the payment for that particular loan. So, that particular payment number corresponding to the weak entity which uniquely identifies it, okay, discriminates this is called the discriminator. The discriminator of a weak entity is also called the partial key. So, it only forms a partial key because along in this example along with the loan number only. So, I have say let us assume I A and B have two loans and loan number 1 and loan number 2. For loan number 1 there may be 10 payments, for loan number 2 there may be 5 payments. So, each of these payments are identified by the payment number, but actually if you want to find for which loan this payment has happened, these two together will be the whole key. The payment number only will be the partial key, that is what we are talking about here. So, this is the discriminator is called is only the partial key. So, if you look here you have employees and you have dependents, we will talk about this later. So, and there is a relation which we will consider later again. So, now here if you look, okay, this employees has a SSN which is the primary key, name and lot, and we will not talk about this now. And then you have dependents where you have p name and age. Now, this p name is the discriminator in this relation. Okay. So, a weak entity can be identified uniquely only by considering the primary key of another owner entity. So, here the dependent depends upon the employee, otherwise the dependent has no independent existence. Okay. owner entity set and weak entity set must participate into one to many relationship, that is for one owner you can have many dependents. So, that is the idea. A weak entity can be identified uniquely only by considering the primary key. Owner entity set and weak entity set must participate into one to one, we have already discussed that, and weak entity must have total participation in this identifying relationship set, this also we have just discussed. Now, why should we have something called weak entities? That is the next question we have to answer. So, this is basically to avoid data duplication and consequent, if you have duplication there are more chances of inconsistencies. So, this is caused by duplicating the key on the strong entity. So, to avoid that you use weak entity, weak entities, and this also gives you the logical structure that one entity does not have an existence without another entity. So, it shows that dependent relationship between the strong entity and the weak entity, and it can be deleted automatically when the strong. So, suppose I have completely deleted all the tuples of a strong entity, automatically I can delete all the weak entities that are dependent upon this strong entity. I do not have to do any checking, and can be stored physically. Normally this weak entity or that relation is stored along with its strong. So, next we will just look at the basics of relation in this lecture, we will be going into detail later. So, a relationship relates two or more entities. So, John majors in computer science. So, this is a student and this is the subject and this majors. And a relationship type is a set of similar relationships. So, a student and entity type is related to department entity type by majors in, which is a relationship type. So, John is a student, majors is the relation and computer science is the department. So, a relation is again a set of tuples, this is to distinguish between what is relation and what is relationship. Relation actually is a table and is a set of tuples. Relationship is actually in entity relationship model describes the relationship between two entities. Both entity types and relation types of the ER model can be represented as tables. So, the notation for this is a diamond, and there are different degrees of relationship, unary, that is it is only for one entity, one entity, binary two entities, ternary three entities, you can have more than three also. So, now we have relation types and sets, we have relationship degree, we have entity roles and recursive relationships. We will be talking about this detail as we go along. I told you that we have more than one lecture on this. So, a relationship is an association among two or more entities. A relation type defines this relationship. Let us look at, and it will normally have the same name. Formally, a relationship type R defines a set of association among n entity types, and a relationship set is the actual tuples that take part in that relationship. So, each EI is said to participate in the relationship type, and each EI is said to participate in the relationship instance. So, the degree is the number of participating entities. As I already explained, you have two entities, three entities, n entities, and the same entity also can participate in relation. So, for example, this is a the same entity also can participate in relation. So, for example, this is a binary relationship works in between departments and employees. This is a ternary 3 between supply between supplier, project and part. So, this is the degree of relationship type, the number of participating entity types. So, binary we have discussed this in detail. So, in summary we have just looked at the basics of relationship. So, we understand ER diagrams, know the meaning of entities, attributes and some basics of relationship, and I want you to construct an ER model for a hospital with a set of patients and a set of medical doctors, and associate with each patient a log of various tests and examinations conducted. So, please try to do this, and I want you to answer this question, why do we have weak entities, and I want to differentiate between strong and weak entities, and give examples of ER diagrams with binary, ternary and n-ary relationship. Thank you.